Welcome to the main post chapel. As you know, this building, this facility, the sanctuary was completed in 1935. We have any first time visitors this morning? Any first time visitors? Continuing on with the sanctuary, if you will look at the stained glass windows, they were not part of the original building. The building was completed in 1935. The stained glass windows were installed in 1945, 10 years later. There will be parish council today. There will be no Bible study. I repeat, there will be no Bible study today. We will have fellowship in the annex after services. We're asking all to please join us in the annex for the fellowship. It's a good time to get to know each other. We're asking those who will be attending the parish council meeting to please try to be seated in the annex in the adjoining room by 11:15 so we can start the meeting. For those of you who have veterans and administration services, you have a little party, you can go there. I'd just like to let you know that they will start getting flu shots tomorrow at the registry VA and the Ringwood Road VA. So if you're excited for that, and also, we're quite surprised to discover that the Ramsey Street VA is going to be building a fisher house. Someone has donated the money for a fisher house to be established at the Ramsey Street VA. Again, welcome to Main Post Chapel. May the grace of the good Father be with you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
If you all would, please stand with me for our call to worship. Our call to worship comes from the book of Revelation, chapter number 7, verses 9 through 12. And it reads, "After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes, were holding palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, 'Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne and to the Lamb.' All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, 'Amen. Praise, glory, and wisdom, and thanks, and honor, and power, and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen.'" Let us sing our opening hymn, number 597, "Take My Life and Let It Be," verses 1, 2, 5, and 6.
Thank you.
now time for us to move on to our responsive reading. They shall be found on the outside and inside covers of your bulletin. I'll read the light portion, you read the dark. It comes from Ephesians chapter 6, verses 5 and 9. Slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear, and with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ.
Obey them not only to win their favor and their eyes upon you, but as slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart, serving wholeheartedly as if you were serving the Lord, not the evil.
Because you know that the Lord will reward each one for whatever good they do, whether they are slave or free, and all together, and masters, treat your slave in the same way. Do not threaten him, since you know that he who is both the master of yours is in heaven, and that there is no favoritism in him. Amen. You all may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We have reached the portion of our service where we actually make our petitions known unto Christ. So it's prayer time. So I ask all of you who may have testimonies or prayer requests to share them at this time. Do we have any prayer requests?
I have one.
Yes, ma'am.
I know this is kind of on everyone's mind, but I just want to ask the Lord to heal this nation. Not only just the rough stuff that we all have going on, but I am so tired of COVID, and I am ready for the Lord to heal this nation, and I want to ask him. If we don't ask, I'm just ready. Not every one of us can be asking the Lord to heal us.
Amen. Do we have a... Yes, sir. Lord, we're reminded of the sweet prayers of the Puritans. O God, may thy spirit speak in me that I may speak with thee. O Lord, whose power is infinite and wisdom infallible, order things that they may be neither hindered nor discouraged, nor prove obstacles to the progress of thy call. Stand between us and all strife. That no evil befall, no sin corrupt our gifts. May we follow the duty and not any foolish devices of our own. Permit us not to labor at work which thou wilt not bless. We may serve thee without disgrace or debt. We are entirely dependent upon thee for support, counsel, and consolation. Uphold us by thy free spirit. We may not think it enough to be preserved from falling, but may we always go forward, always abounding in the work thou givest us to do. Strengthen us by thy spirit. Thy inner cells for the every purpose of our Christian life. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we remember the words of the Apostle Paul. We pray that you would give us the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that we may know you better. We pray that the eyes of our heart may be enlightened in order that we may know the hope to which you've called us, the riches of your glorious inheritance in your holy name. Lord, prepare a great power for us to believe. That power is the same as the mighty strength you exerted when you raised Christ from the dead and seated him at the right hand in heavenly realms, far above rule and authority, power and dominion, in every name that is invoked, not in the present age, but in the one to come. Lord, we come this morning to commend your fatherly goodness to all of those that in any way are afflicted or distressed. In mind, body, or any other way, Lord, we thank you for what you've done in Miss Stewart's life and what you've done in Mr. Phillips' life. Lord, we come before you asking you now to heal this nation. And may it please you to comfort and relieve them that are still suffering under the ailment of COVID-19. Lord, we ask that you would bless them and deliver them out of their affliction. May the cross and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, your Son, refresh your people and their trials and give them strength to keep on pushing on. Lord, you declare that the sufferings of this life are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. Lord, we now look to those that are in positions of leadership and authority. We ask God that you would grant them wisdom and integrity. May they be humble and dependent and supremely joyful. Lord, always let them remember the blessedness that accompanies devotion. When they're under trials that weary them, the cares that may corrode them, the fears that may disturb them, and your quiet, still voice, remind them that you're still in charge. And as we do as a family, we pray for the advancement of your gospel. As a congregation, we pray that you would bless, protect, and provide for us in the coming days. Help us to be joyful, sacrificially be the eyes, ears, hands, feet of Jesus to each other and to our neighbors. Lord, we desire the good news of your salvation to extend to all of the earth. Let us be more like you. Let us see more conversion. Bring lost people to us and into this chapel. Save our children. May all who grow up hearing the gospel believe it in its entirety. Save our lost spouses and co-workers and friends, enemies and neighbors. Now God, prepare our hearts to receive you. May it change us. May it wash us, shape us, refine us, and shatter any misconception about you. Reconstruct our values. Make us different. Make us less so that you can be made more. And we thank you for that. We ask all of these things to the one who is King, Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. If the ushers would please come forward. Now time for our tithes and offerings. Time for our hymn of preparation, hymn number 591, Have Thine Own Way, Lord.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It is indeed good to see each and every one of you. How are you all feeling?
I'm blessed.
I'm well. Thank you so much. How about out here? How's everyone feel? Amen. Amen. I was hoping to get a little better response, but I'll take what I receive, okay? All right. If you would, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Well, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for this opportunity to be as a family once again. We ask, for Heavenly Father, that your word would speak to our lives, to our spirits, God, that we would be able to live out your word in its fullness. We ask, for Heavenly Father, that we would walk as children of the light, as Paul said in Ephesians 5. Lord, that that light would draw you. We ask, for Heavenly Father, that you just be with us during this time. So we can pray through prayer. Amen.
Amen.
Ephesians chapter 6, verses 5-9. We've read them before, but we will read them again. Slaves, be obedient to them that are your masters, according to the flesh, with fear and trembling, in singleness of your heart as unto Christ, not with eye service, as men please, but as the slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, with good will doing service, as to the Lord and not to men. Knowing that whatsoever good thing any man doeth, the same shall he receive of the Lord, whether he be bond, slave, or free. And ye masters, do the same things unto them who are bearing brethren, knowing that your master also is in heaven, neither is there respect of persons for him. Amen. Before I jump into the text, just a couple of things, quick things that I want to share. Over the last, I would say 4.5 months that I have been the senior pastor, it has indeed been a joy, a pleasure to serve. And as my time draws near, it is going to be a difficult transition, but we believe that God is going to provide in the midst of that. Amen. I will be moving along to Iraq for a season, but God will provide another person to provide his word for his people during this season. We just need to believe that. Amen? So again, it has been a pleasure to serve, and I still have, I think, 2 more weeks before the transition. But this may be my last time before you in this capacity. All right, so now let's transition to our text. By 1860, Mississippi's farms and plantations yielded 1.2 million bales of cotton, making it the leading cotton producer in the United States. This prosperity rested on the backs of some 436,000 enslaved blacks, who constituted 55% of the state's population, and who made Mississippi the third largest slave-holding state behind Virginia and Georgia. Without question, our passage has been used to justify the Atlantic slave trade and slave holding, capturing, human oppression in my home state of Mississippi. Illegitimately, this passage has been used to justify the ill treatment of people of all races and genders. Slavery was interwoven into the fabric of society. As a result, as believers, we must ask ourselves the question, well, is this right? And does Christianity openly support the demonization of certain races of people? So this morning, we'll examine the text. And we'll do some work on context and definition. So we can separate. When the Bible speaks of slaves and masters, we need to understand the context. I remember I spoke, I was sharing with my wife. I said, I'm speaking, preaching on slavery tomorrow. She's like, slavery? She said, what is the context? Well, context is important. Are all historical practices of slavery identical, and are they equal to each other? Does embrace of one context mean that I agree with the other context? Secondly, we need to understand Paul's pastoral intent for this message. And lastly, we'll conclude with how can we apply this message to our lives, considering we live in a very different context. First context, we must evaluate the Old Testament context, which surely shaped Paul's thinking on this matter. We must be careful, family, not to superimpose our own ideas of slavery within the Western Hemisphere onto this text. As we evaluate the Old Testament text on the matter, we see that slavery was not in every context a moral evil. This is provided to us in the Old Testament. The law permitted and gave guidelines for Israel to impose the punishment of slavery upon foreign nations as an act of divine judgment against those nations. We see this in Leviticus chapter 25, verses 44 through 46. And it reads, "And as for your male and female slaves whom you may have, from the nations that are around you, from them you may buy male and female slaves. Moreover, you may buy the children of the strangers who dwell among you, and their families who are with you, which they begot in your land, and they shall become your property. And you may take them as an inheritance for your children after you, to inherit them as a possession. They shall be your permanent slave. But regarding your brethren, the children of Israel, you shall not rule over one another with rigor." Additionally, we see that the law allowed for an Israelite to enter into the state of slavery as a form of punishment if he stole something and was unable to pay. We see this in Exodus 22, verses 1 through 3. "Whosoever steals an ox or a sheep and slaughters it or sells it must pay back 5 head of cattle for the ox, and 4 sheep for the sheep. If a thief is caught breaking in at night and is struck a fatal blow, the defender is not guilty of bloodshed. But if it happens after sunrise, the defender is guilty of bloodshed." Here we go. "Anyone who steals must enslave whomever they want." The indiscriminate stealing of and enslaving of others, what the Bible considers man-stealing, is prohibited in the Old Testament.
death.
This is in Exodus chapter 21,
verse number 16. Anyone who kidnaps someone is to be put to death, whether the victim has been sold or still in the kidnapper's possession. So the law did not allow the Israelites to enslave anyone they wanted, or were they allowed to treat legitimate slaves any way they wanted. Masters were instructed, and when you let your slave go free from you, you shall not let him go empty-handed. You shall furnish him liberally, out of your flock and out of your threshing floor and out of your wine press. As the Lord your God has blessed you, you shall give to him. Deuteronomy 15, 13 through 14. Most importantly, any slavery of Israelites was not for life, but only for 6 years, unless it was an act of divine judgment against the nation, Exodus 21, verse 2. While it is true that there are forms of judicial slavery in the Old Testament, this practice of slavery was very different from the practices of slavery in the United States, and it is untrue that this slavery is a justification for the practice of slavery that was known in this country. And so now we have context. Amen? And so now let's look at slavery in Paul's day. In Paul's day, slavery was interwoven again into the fabric of society. It was legal in the Greco-Roman law. To give you an idea how pervasive slavery was, it says that in Ephesus, approximately one-third of the population were slaves. Most of them worked in agrarian context and were therefore crucial to the stability of that society. Economic stability depended upon them. The food supply depended upon them. Slaves would have become slaves for a number of different reasons. Perhaps it was military conquest. Of course, that has been outlawed, but when you go in, you take a particular land, all of the people would now become your slaves. Perhaps a person fell into economic hardship and thus had no other option but to sell themselves into slavery for a time, what we would call indentured servantship. In those days, unwanted infants were sometimes left outside for exposure, and people would come by and grab them and sell them into slavery. Others were simply just born into slavery. Unfortunately, it was not the all uncommon practice for slaves to be mistreated or treated harshly by their masters. Neither was it uncommon for slaves to be rebellious and even violent towards their masters. And so Paul writes the church at Ephesus, and he knew that there would be slaves and masters within the congregation. Paul addressed the relationship between master and slave as he gave instructions for the household. If we look at verse chapter 15, starting at verse 15, and going all the way through chapter 6, verse number 9, that is called the household codes. And you see that Paul outlines very specifically instructions for husbands and wives. Captain Yours preached on this several weeks ago. Then he has very specific instructions about children obeying their parents. Captain Beaver, I think, spoke on this last week. And he goes on to say, slaves, obey your master. And now we're here at Ephesians chapter 6. We're going to look at chapter 6, verses 5 through 8, kind of together. And so here we'll read again. Slaves, be obedient to them that are your masters according to the flesh, with fear and trembling and singleness of your heart, as unto Christ. Not with eye service as men pleases, but as the slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, with good will, doing service as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that whatsoever good thing any man doeth, the same shall he receive of the Lord, whether he be bond, slave, or free, to the flesh with fear and trembling, and singleness of your heart, as to Christ. So if we look at the first word, slaves, be obedient to your masters, the Greek word slave there, doulos, is often translated as bondservant. You'll see that in some translations, bondservant. However, the word there is actually slave, and instead it's used sometimes as bondservant for political correctness. But it is slave. To the slaves within the church, Paul wrote, obey your earthly masters. And I want us to notice a couple of things here. First, Paul does not encourage the slaves to take off their yokes and to rebel against the master. That's number one. Rather, he says to obey them with fear and trembling. Secondly, notice that he does not qualify the statement by saying, obey your earthly masters if they are kind and just. He does not provide that qualification. Thirdly, what Paul says to slaves corresponds with what Paul says to others regarding submission to authority that is older. Children are to obey their parents in the Lord. Wives are to submit to their husbands as to the Lord. And in other places, Paul addresses the Christian submission to civil authority. And he makes no exemption for rulers that are ungodly. He says, let every person be subject to the governing authorities. Kind of difficult to deal with, huh? Where's Paul going with this? Where's he going with this? So, Paul commands Christians to obey their earthly masters. This is a difficult idea to take hold of. Why, Paul? Just as a child is to obey their parents, so slaves are to obey their masters. Though all are equal in Christ, as we will see, and though all humans are equal, given that we have been made in the image of God, what really is Paul getting? What he's getting at is that the world has been designed in such a way that we have authority over others within society. Obedience is to be offered up to those who have position of authority. Secondly, Paul commands Christian slaves to obey their masters from the heart. This principle is peppered throughout verses 5 through 8. Slaves are to obey with fear and trembling. They are to have a true and sincere respect for their masters. Not in the way of eye service or pleasing people. Not superficially, but sincerely. From the heart. Listen to Colossians 3:24. Whatever you do, do your work heartily as for the Lord rather than for men, knowing that from the Lord you receive the reward of your inheritance. In other words, you're not working for those that are over. That work is being submitted as though it is being given unto you. They have served their masters faithfully in a way that is becoming of a Christian, truly wishing them to do good and not evil. Consider The Old Testament text, Genesis chapter 28, one of my favorite Old Testament characters by the name of Joseph. Joseph was thrown in a pit and sold into slavery. Not one time do we hear of Joseph removing the yoke of the slave. He stayed the course. He served his master. And this is the way Christian slaves should serve, sincerely and from the heart, reinserting service with the will, goodwill, the text says. Thirdly, Paul commands slaves to sincerely obey their masters as to Christ. This principle is key as slaves are to consistently serve their earthly masters, especially those that are unjust. You all have been in a position where you had someone that was over you, that was unjust, and you had to serve them anyway. That's a difficult position to be in. They are to render service with goodwill as to the Lord and not to man. You are to serve the person in that capacity the best way that you can. Because your service is not to the man or to the woman, your service is only. Believe this. You may be into a tree and poorly in return for your service. But God sees your faithful service and your unjust treatment. And he will reward them both. Lastly, as we evaluate the verses, we see something yet interesting. We witness Paul's silence and that he does not demand for the masters to free the slaves. He does not appeal to the Roman authorities. Why, Paul? Why is it that you go silent? Why is it that you didn't stand up and try to get slavery abolished? This has been the source of great disappointment for many who wanted to see the Apostle Paul and the church take on social and political reform. And they see the silence of this matter something that is truly hurtful. Yet what is clear from this text and Paul's other texts is Paul's primary concern. And it should also be the church's primary concern. It is not political reform. It is not social reform. It is not any of those things. His epistles are not political steps to transform the Greco-Roman society from the outside in. Paul's letters are not political works of political theory outlining what makes a government legitimate, what makes rights and freedoms it should protect, what form it should take. Nor are his letters expositions on the importance of having a biblically centered governmental structure. These are not Paul's concerns. Not to say these things are not important, but these are not Paul's concerns. So what is Paul's primary concern? Paul's primary concern of the church is that it is to bear witness of the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That is what we are to do. Paul's desire for the church is to bear witness. His calling is that he may share this message with unbelievers that they may believe. In Christ will be saved into the this salvation. Paul makes two things very clear in his writings. As a result of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, God has created a new humanity in the church. And within this body of believers, there is no slave and no free. Although the great Roman Empire drew a line in the sand, Christ himself raised it. All members of the church have equal standing, full and complete union with Christ as members of the church, whether slave or free, equal or in dignity, equal in worth and equal in spiritual blessing. Galatians 3:28. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Colossians 3:11. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, very important statement, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. In Christ, there is no slave or free. And this is the knowledge that we need to have as we go into the world to serve our earthly master. Do not be done in a way that is agreeable on the surface, but rather this form of service should be done from the heart with joy and thanksgiving. Bearing in mind Philippians chapter 2, 6 through 8, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a slave, and coming in the likeness of men. Being found in the appearance of man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Better understand what Paul is doing right here is revolutionary. It's provocative and controversial. Why? Why is it revolutionary? Look at verse number 9. Masters do the same to them. Finally, we come to Paul's instructions for the Christian masters. And as I've said, these words seem radical in the first century Roman world. Why? Masters do the same to them and stop your threatening, knowing that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven. And that there is no partiality with him. He commands masters to do the same things that he's commanding the slaves to do. This is revolutionary. Because if you look at the slave, the way that Christ would look at them, the way you treat them would reflect that. Remember how Paul, after commanding slaves to obey their masters, also addressed the heart? Well, in the same way, Paul addresses the heart of the master. And stop your threatening. Masters should not even have an oppressive, harsh, or condescending tone. But in love, they should reflect love. The love of Christ. I remember how Paul urged the slaves to obey their masters as unto the Lord. Well, Paul also urges masters to treat their servants as equals, being mindful of God who is in heaven. They were to do the same thing to them and stop their threatening, knowing that he who is both their master is yours and is in heaven. Every human authority must wield the power with a heart of service. In love means
ever mindful of themselves under the authority of God. So what are we to take from them? How are we to apply this in our own lives? The primary way that the text is applied to our own life is in the context of work. As workers, we all find ourselves under authority, as we said before. And our lives should be a light for those that are above us. And for those of us that find ourselves in positions of authority, we should be mindful that our lives should also be a light for those that are subordinate to us. I remember reading a quote some time ago, and it says, "The man who is mean to the waiter is not a very nice man." The people that you have, the people that are around you, that you get nothing good out of serving them but the gratification of being a Christian, that those encounters really show what type of person you truly are. By doing this, we bear witness to Christ in our own lives. And that's what the text is all about. Bearing witness to Christ in our own life, despite the situation, despite the hardship, how are you going to respond? You remember in Ephesians 5, it said that you were darkness, but now you are light. Walk as children of light. Amen. Walk as children of the light. Our lives should reflect Christ despite the hardship or the situation. Because that is what it means. We live in a world where the strong oppresses the weak. But in Christ, we are united as one. We are all made in God's image, sinners saved by grace.